From Pacifica Network, broadcasting from New York, this is Democracy Now!
Here you have this sort of amazing freight train coming down the road from January on, and the highest powers in this administration, Rumsfeld and Wolfowitz and the president, they're just running around rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic.
Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter Seymour Hersh releases more photos showing terrorized Iraqi prisoners at Abu Ghraib. As the White House defends Donald Rumsfeld, Vice President Cheney calling him the greatest defense secretary the U.S. has ever had. Some of the military police involved with the torture were prison guards here in the United States. We'll speak with the editor and founder of Prison Legal News. He was a military police officer himself, released from prison after 15 years. And Lori Berenson's case goes to the Inter-American Court. We'll speak with her father, Mark Berenson.
The court can decide to release Lori, to give her another trial, or to vote for Peru. There's only one correct, honorable, and just decision, and that's Lori's release.
All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman. The Washington Post is reporting top U.S. military leaders in Iraq are admitting publicly for the first time that the U.S. may be losing the war in Iraq. The commander of the 82nd Airborne Division, Army Major General Charles Swanick, told the Post the U.S. is winning on a tactical level but losing strategically. Army Colonel Paul Hughes, who's involved with formulating Iraq policy, compared Iraq to Vietnam. He told the Washington Post, quote, "I lost my brother in Vietnam. I promised myself when I came on active duty that I would do everything in my power to prevent that sort of strategic loss from happening again. Here I am, 30 years later, thinking we will win every fight and lose the war because we don't understand the war we are in." Another senior general at the Pentagon said, quote, "It's doubtful we can go much longer like this. The American people may not stand for it, and they should not." Republican Senator Chuck Hagel also raised questions on Sunday and faced the nation about whether the U.S. was losing. He said, quote, "I think we're right on the edge in Iraq right now. I think it's still in question whether Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld and, quite frankly, General Myers can command the respect and the trust and the confidence of the military of the American people to lead this country." The civilian military publication Army Times is planning to run an editorial today saying Rumsfeld and Myers should possibly resign for their role in the growing Iraq prison abuse scandal. The paper said Rumsfeld and Myers are responsible for, quote, "a failure that amounts to professional negligence," and that, quote, "accountability is essential, even if that means relieving top leaders from duty in a time of war." On Friday, Rumsfeld testified for 6 hours before the Senate and House. He apologized for the abuse, defended how the Pentagon handled the situation, and rejected calls for resignation. The Bush White House continues to back Rumsfeld, Vice President Dick Cheney calling the best defense secretary the country has ever seen. But the scandal continues to grow as more photos emerge and leaders in Washington warn the worst may still be forthcoming. Republican Senator Lindsey Graham from South Carolina said Friday, "The American public needs to understand we're talking about rape and murder here. We're not just talking about giving people a humiliating experience." President Bush has reportedly asked the Pentagon to personally review all photos and video in their possession. The Pentagon announced Sunday 24-year-old Army Specialist Jeremy Sivitz will face a public court-martial next month in Iraq, becoming the first U.S. soldier to stand trial for his role in the prison abuse scandal. He's among seven former soldiers at Abu Ghraib facing criminal charges. Sivitz reportedly took some of the photos that showed the U.S. abusing Iraqi prisoners. The Army's planning to hold the court-martial in public at a convention center in Baghdad. Iraq's former human rights minister, Abdelbaset Turki, has told Agence France-Presse that the head of the U.S. occupation, Paul Bremer, ignored his warnings about abuses taking place in Iraqi prisons. Bremer also barred the human rights minister from visiting the prisons. The minister resigned last month to protest U.S. policies, including the siege of Fallujah, which killed up to 600 Iraqis. Britain's counterpart to Donald Rumsfeld, Defense Secretary Geoff Hoon, is scheduled to appear before the House of Parliament today to respond to questions about an emerging prison abuse scandal involving British troops. He will likely be asked to respond to reports that the Red Cross and Amnesty International had warned Britain about prison abuses in Iraq as early as a year ago. In Britain on Tuesday, attorneys representing 20 Iraqi families will appear in court charging British soldiers from at least four regiments killed detainees and shot unarmed civilians. The government has admitted 18 Iraqis have died in the custody of British troops, but according to the London Independent, no British soldier has been charged, disciplined, or dismissed. Meanwhile, Time magazine has obtained an internal Pentagon memo that warned employees last week not to read or download the prison abuse scandal report that had been leaked to the media because it's a classified document. The Pentagon also ordered employees not to discuss the report with coworkers or family members. Part of the email read in all capital letters, quote, "The information contained in this report is classified. Do not go to Fox News or obtain a copy." The San Francisco Chronicle is reporting the U.S. occupation of Iraq will end up costing $150 billion by the end of next year and may end up costing $300 billion over the next decade, making it one of the costliest military campaigns in modern history. According to the paper, the Bush administration has now spent about $3 in Iraq for every dollar committed to homeland security here at home. In Iraq, 500 Iraqi scholars met in Baghdad this weekend to develop a plan to end the U.S. occupation. The organizers call themselves the United Iraqi Scholars Group and included Shia, Sunni, and Kurdish scholars who oppose the U.S. presence in Iraq. According to the BBC, the conference set up a 16-member panel and pledged to boycott any U.S.-sponsored political group, including the Iraqi Governing Council. The group also pledged to reestablish the National Army and to restore sovereignty under the auspices of the United Nations. The president of Chechnya, Ahmad Kadyrov, was assassinated Sunday when a bomb exploded at a stadium where he was celebrating Russia's biggest holiday, Victory Day. Chechen separatist groups have claimed responsibility for the blast, which killed 13 others. The commander of Russia's 70,000 occupation forces in Chechnya was also critically injured in that blast. A journalist with Reuters is among the dead. Kadyrov was widely seen to be a puppet leader of Russian President Vladimir Putin, who helped secure his election last fall by orchestrating the removal of his chief opponents. After Kadyrov's controversial election, Putin declared the war in Chechnya to be over. But now the Christian Science Monitor is reporting Putin's plan for stabilizing occupied Chechnya is in tatters. One Chechen expert in Moscow said, quote, "This blow is comparable to the Americans losing their top administrator in Iraq." Putin announced that the Kremlin-appointed prime minister of Chechnya would serve as acting president until elections are held. In Venezuela, President Hugo Chavez said his government has detained a group of 56 Colombian paramilitaries who he said were plotting to kill him or overthrow the government. The Colombians were arrested at a farm on the outskirts of Caracas. Chavez says the farm was owned by a Cuban exile with close ties to opponents who had previously tried to stage a coup. In Afghanistan, a U.S. Marine was shot dead Saturday, marking the first time a Marine has been killed by enemy fire in the country since the U.S. invaded in October of 2001. A total of 121 U.S. troops have now died in Afghanistan. A new report from Public Citizen has found President Bush and the Republican National Committee have received $6.6 million in campaign donations in the past 5 years from the owners of the dirtiest power plants in the country. In return, the companies were given relief from pollution regulations that would have cost them billions of dollars. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman. The U.S. military announced this weekend it will begin its first court-martial in the Abu Ghraib prisoner abuse scandal since graphic images of U.S. personnel abusing Iraqi prisoners were first broadcast April 28th. On May 19th, proceedings will begin against Specialist Jeremy Civitz, a member of the 372nd Military Police Company. Brigadier General Mark Kimmett made the announcement in the Iraqi capital and said the proceedings would be held at the Baghdad Convention Center, which houses the coalition press office. Kimmett said the trial will be open to the media. Civitz is one of seven soldiers facing charges, but appears to be a lesser figure in the case. He's believed to have taken some of the photos of U.S. personnel abusing the prisoners. Amnesty International has labeled some of the actions depicted in the photos as war crimes, while the Vatican said the conduct of the soldiers at the prison, quote, offended God. Meanwhile, the Bush administration continues to defend Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld. Several lawmakers have called for his resignation, while some have gone so far as to begin drafting articles of impeachment against him. In a statement issued late Saturday, Vice President Dick Cheney said, quote, I think Donald Rumsfeld is the best Secretary of Defense the United States has ever had. People ought to let him do his job, unquote. On Friday, Rumsfeld spent more than 6 hours in front of the Senate and House Armed Services Committees. Republican Senator John McCain questioned Rumsfeld on the chain of command at Abu Ghraib and the role of private contractors at the prison.
Now, Mr. Secretary, I'd like to know, I'd like you to give the committee the chain of command from the guards to you, all the way up the chain of command.
I think General Myers brought it. Indication of it, we'll show it.
Thank you. I'd like to know who was in charge of the, what agencies or private contractors were in charge of interrogations? Did they have authority over the guards? And what were their instructions to the guards?
First, with respect to the...
We did not bring it.
Oh, my.
Yeah, oh, my. Is right.
It was all prepared.
It was. Indeed.
Do you want to walk through it?
Well, anyway, who is in charge, what agency or private contractor was in charge of the interrogations? Did they have authority over the guards? And what were the instructions that they gave to the guards?
I'll walk through the chain of command and...
You can submit the chain of command, please.
General Smith, do you want to respond?
No, Secretary Rumsfeld, in all due respect, you've got to answer this question, and it could be satisfied with a phone call. This is a pretty simple, straightforward question. Who was in charge of the interrogations? What agencies and what or private contractors were in charge of the interrogations? Did they have authority over the guards? And what were the instructions to the guards? This goes to the heart of this matter.
It does indeed. As I understand it, there were two contractor organizations. They supplied interrogators and linguists. And I was advised by General Smith that there were maybe a total of 40.
Now, were they in charge of the interrogations?
37 interrogators and
37
witnesses' voices are not being recorded. You'll have to speak into your microphone. Would you repeat the conversation in response to the senator's question?
Yes, sir. There were 37 interrogators that were...
I'm asking who was in charge of the interrogations.
So they were not in charge. They were interrogators.
My question is, who was in charge of the interrogations?
The brigade commander for the military intelligence brigade.
And did he also have authority over the guards?
Sir, he had tactical control over the guards, so he was...
Secretary, you can't answer these questions?
I can. I thought the purpose of the question was to try to make sure we got an accurate presentation, and we have the expert here who was in the chain of command.
I think these are fundamental questions to this issue.
Fine.
Were the instructions to the guards?
There's two sets of responsibilities, as your question suggests. One set are the people who have the responsibility for managing the detention process. They are not interrogators. The military intelligence people, as General Smith has indicated, were the people who were in charge of the interrogation part of the process. And the responsibility, as I have reviewed the matter, shifted over a period of time. And the general is capable of telling you when that responsibility shifted.
What were the instructions to the guards?
That is what the investigation that I've indicated has been undertaken
Secretary, that's a very simple, straightforward question.
Well, as Chief of Staff of the Army can tell you, the guards are trained to guard people. They're not trained to interrogate. And their instructions are to, in the case of Iraq, adhere to the Geneva Conventions. The Geneva Conventions apply to all of the individuals there in one way or another. They apply to the prisoners of war, and they're written out, and they're instructed, and the people in the Army train them to that, and the people in the Central Command have the responsibility of seeing that, in fact, their conduct is consistent with the Geneva Conventions. The criminals in the same detention facility are handled under a different provision of the Geneva Convention. I believe it's the fourth, and the prior one is the third.
So the guards were instructed to treat the prisoners under some kind of changing authority, as I understand it, according to the Geneva Conventions.
Absolutely.
Senator John McCain questioning Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld. Senator McCain was a prisoner of war during the Vietnam War. One of the most talked about statements made by Rumsfeld during his appearances on Capitol Hill was that the photos currently in the public domain are just a fraction of the videos and pictures of U.S. personnel abusing Iraqi prisoners. Pentagon's fighting to keep these images from reaching the public and has been negotiating with Congress in an effort to keep them sealed. But more images keep on emerging. The New Yorker magazine just released a series of photos showing what appears to be dogs attacking a naked Iraqi prisoner. The photos are part of the latest article by Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Seymour Hersh. It's called Chain of Command: How the Department of Defense Mishandled the Disaster at Abu Ghraib. Last night, I spoke with Seymour Hersh about his piece.
The most important thing I discovered is that most of the people in the chain of command weren't really informed about what was going on. In other words, people that normally would have been alerted to the problems they had at the prison in Iraq, Al Gharib prison, weren't cut in. It seems as if this administration simply, if it was it's not even a cover-up. It's so much more profound than that. What they do in this administration at the top is they simply are incapable of dealing with bad news. So here you have this sort of this disastrous event come forth. Somebody comes up with the photographs, and you know it's clear that if this young man and one of the military policemen at the prison hadn't decided this was wrong and hadn't gone into the authorities there, I think January the 13th of this year, with the photographs, if he hadn't had the videos or the discs, everything would still be exactly the way it was. You know, Janice Karpinski, the general who ran that brigade, would still be doing it, and the abuses probably would still be going on. But he had the video, and so they had to act. And so it gets briefed into Washington, and here you have this sort of amazing freight train coming down the road from January on, and the highest powers in this administration, Rumsfeld and Wolfowitz and the president, they're just running around rearranging the deck chairs on the Titanic, you know, any cliche you want. They're simply because it's something they couldn't deal with. And then in talking to officers, and actually what I wrote I've known for a long time, some of the, for example, the JCS and Army planners have been trying to tell the Rumsfeld and others for a year how bad things are going and how wrong the estimates are about troop strength and what's needed, and you just can't get them to listen. They only listen to their own little voices, I guess. It's really amazing. And you can understand this sort of inability to hear this self-deception they practice. They really, I think, some of them may really believe six or seven bad seeds, six or seven bad kids were responsible for what happened in the prison system, and that the idea that there's something systematic and something that they may have, you know, inadvertently or advertently, we don't know yet, start.
Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter Seymour Hersh will talk with him about the latest picture that has been released in a minute.
The pledge to resist. We believe that as a people living in the United States, it is our responsibility to resist the injustices done by our government in our name.
This is Democracy Now!, Saul Williams, not in my name. The War and Peace Report, looking at Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter Seymour Hersh's article in today's New Yorker magazine called Chain of Command, How the Department of Defense Mishandled the Disaster at Abu Ghraib. He writes, one of the new photographs shows a young soldier wearing a dark jacket over his uniform and smiling into the camera in the corridor of the jail. In the background are two army dog handlers in full camouflage combat gear restraining two German shepherds. The dogs are barking at a man who's partly obscured from the camera's view by the smiling soldier. Another image shows that the man, an Iraqi prisoner, is naked. We spoke to Seymour Hersh last night about the photo.
Well, there were two dogs. There were about 20 I saw altogether. And they were taken by two different cameras over 12 minutes. And one was quite, the one that the New Yorker published was quite graphic. But they show this, what can I tell you, this terrified man. You know, we've seen pictures like that before in Mississippi during the Civil War day, the Civil Rights Marches, and in the World War II, we've seen photographs like that. But American military policemen and intelligence officers doing that. I quote one general, retired major general, a man named Hines, that ran the military police, that was in the police business for 28 years as an army officer. He said if he'd ever done anything like that, he would have been kicked out of the army. This is, you know, six, 7 years or more back. So the progression shows that he's terrified, and eventually we don't see the dogs biting him, but we see him on the ground, a lot of blood around, and a large gash in his foot, in his thigh rather, up the thigh. And so it's clear that the dog bit him, although we don't actually see it in the 20 or so shots I have. But, the thing that's amazing about it, there are two interesting things about it. Well, actually, three, really. One, of course, is it's just another day on the job for everybody. Nobody's stopping. There's four or five people around in some of the photos. Two, there were two different cameras going, as I said, which means two people were photographing, not just one. It's more than just casual, the photography business. I think it's part of the interrogation process. And three, what's really much more interesting in terms of the Army's and White House's insistence that this is just a few, it's a different group of men and women. The six or seven people that are undergoing investigation and possible criminal sanctions right now are all from a company known as the 372nd Military Police MP Company. These slides and snapshots came from someone in the 320th MP Battalion, a different group, same prison, same probably area of the prison, but nonetheless, different organization, a different unit. So the idea that it's what was going on there was limited to one unit is wrong. And then elsewhere in the story I quote another, I don't quote him by name, but another a young captain who ran a military police company at yet another prison at roughly the same time. This is last fall. These photographs were taken. The photograph in the New Yorker this week was, taken the night of evening of December the 2nd, or late afternoon, December the 12th, rather, last year. But at that same time, in a prison, you know, near Baghdad, yet another facility, the same sort of pressure was being put on by the military intelligence people. So what you're really seeing, you're beginning to see some evidence, if photographs are evidence, which I think they are, of a much more systematic mistreatment of prisoners.
You also talk about the connections between Iraq, Guantanamo, and Afghanistan, and talk about how John Walker Lynn was dealt with, the American prisoner who was captured in Afghanistan.
Right, and he pleaded to 20 years. Well, what's interesting, one of the things in this sort of, I think in this article I described him as the fearless Antonio Taguba, the famous Taguba report that everybody was talking about and writing about last week. One of the things he said was very interesting, and he had said that the problems in the prison system, as far as he can tell, he was brought onto the scene after the photographs came in. He was ordered to do an investigation in late January, which he completed in about a month or maybe 5 or 6 weeks. But in his report, he said there had been two previous studies, and one of them, in one of the studies, another Army general had mentioned that this it all came out of Afghanistan. Project Enduring Freedom was the code word. And that, you go back and you then think about that, and you go back and look at John Walker Lynn, and I talked to his attorney, a man named James Brosnahan in California, who sent me some of the filings on the case, some of the affidavits. You know how the press is when he was around. It was very interesting, and once he got, everybody sort of stopped paying attention to it after a little while. But in one of the affidavits, it's very clear that what happened to him after he was arrested in December 2001, he was stripped, and two times over the next few days, people were allowed in to take snapshots. A number of photographs were taken of him. In fact, one of him, nude and stripped, ended up being given to one of the networks. So you had a pattern of people photographing you, and also the nudeness and the abusiveness. And one of the people, there were two investigations. One of the investigations last summer that was done in Iraq on the prison system was done by a man named Major General Jeffrey Miller, who was at that time running the prison at Guantanamo, which is strictly an interrogation facility. And the timeline is this, that by last fall, the American authorities were talking publicly, the insurgency was going, and they were talking publicly about 5,000 or so members of the insurgencies, and there was a tremendous pressure that, who are the insurgents? Let's find them. Let's get them. And so what happened is that the best guess you have is by late fall, they have as many as 40,000 detainees, and they're not like the people that were taken out of Afghanistan and sent to Guantanamo. Overwhelmingly, 60 to more percentage of them are civilians, are people that have nothing, they were just picked up randomly, and there's not much intelligence to get out of them. And anyway, there is a separate prison for the hard cases that we're not talking about. They weren't at El Gharib. There were other places. And so what you were doing is you were trying to find the 5,000 magic guys. And Miller recommended to do so that you put the military intelligence people last fall in charge of the prisons. And Ricardo Sanchez, all of this I read about this article, promulgated an order. They call it a FRAG operational order, promulgated an order last November the 19th, putting military intelligence in charge of all the prisons. And that meant that the interrogators, literally that meant that you're going to end up with, Guantanamos all over the place, in which the whole function of the prison system was eliciting information. And so the brutality seemed to connect directly with this recommendation, November, December. And so you had a system where, and by the way, every expert in interrogation, and anybody in the American government and elsewhere tells you that interrogations by coercion produce nothing, because people only tell you what they think you want. They're the most useless thing. Nonetheless, there seems to have been a widespread decision made. A decision was made, and it was decided to escalate the pressure on the people. And one of the ways, if you're going to humiliate people as they do, as we did, we know from the photographs, sexually and other ways, I can tell you right now, I don't know this empirically, but I've been told by many people that there was nothing would be as threatening to an Arab man as the idea that you had photographs of him in this horrible position that you could show to friends, neighbors, and family. It would be a shaming that would be, as shameful, and his life would be over in a sense in terms of his personal integrity in the community. And so out of this, the cameras seem to be much more important, much more systematic. We don't know the answers to all these questions, but inevitably you're led to thinking that what's happening here is not just something random, but something not only just deliberately or just inadvertently deliberate, people come to the same thing at the same place, but there seems to be some sort of overriding system or, a gathering, some notion of how to do it. And therefore, you have some central authority, and therefore, somebody like me who thinks heuristically would say somewhere there's something going on that we have to find out. There's some central mechanism for this.
We're talking to Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter Seymour Hersh. When did Donald Rumsfeld, the Secretary of Defense, learn about this? When did President Bush?
Well, all we can go is by what they say, and we have to take them at their word on this because we have no basis or otherwise. To give you some idea, and here's the iron, this is confusing to me, and it should be confusing to everybody. The kid, January the 13th, the photographs come out. We now know that by 2:30 the next morning, this is from accounts of the various people who are being prosecuted. One of them, in letters home, said by 2:30 the next morning, he was rousted out by the Army Police, CID, the Criminal Investigation Division, who are pretty straight guys. They do their job. They love to burn officers. Anyway, he's rousted out. By 2:30 the next morning, they're on the hunt for people, and they're identifying people in the photographs. Rumsfeld is testified by the 16th. That's 2 days later. He was notified it, and he told the president right away. We know by the 19th, General Sanchez orders an investigation, and a few weeks later, he orders Tacuba to do his big report. So within a week, certainly, of the photograph showing up inside this prison at a Army Criminal Investigation Division office, within 6-7 days, the president knows, Rumsfeld knows, an investigation's begun, and the process is underway.
And again, the month and day?
January of between the 13th and the 19th, all this happened. Rumsfeld says no photographs were seen, but certainly he must have had a very, very explicit account of what, or something rational that would make him, compel him. Somebody had to be worried enough so that they told the SecDef right away, because as he's testified, there's 18,000 court-martials in the military system a year. How am I supposed to know all of them, he said at one point in his testimony before Congress last week. So Something was special about this right away. But then I think what I'm telling you is the mechanism then is there's very bad news coming. Nobody wants to hear bad news in this administration, so it just disappears. I know that sounds bizarre, but the disconnects inside this government, particularly on, you know, as we all see in the Iraqi policy, are just sort of amazing.
Seymour Hersh, you say that the pictures yet to come unreleased. NBC News quoting U.S. military officials saying they show American soldiers severely beating an Iraqi prisoner nearly to death, having sex with a female Iraqi prisoner, and acting inappropriately with a dead body. The official said there also is a videotape apparently shot by U.S. personnel showing Iraqi guards raping young boys. Where are these videos and photographs?
Well, the Army clearly has some of them, but the big fear they have is, you know, this is the CD, Napster burn CD generation. Before the investigation began in early January, these were being passed around throughout the brigade that of which Janice Karpinski was the 800th MP brigade. We're talking about 3,000 or 4,000 people. God knows how many copies and how many videos are out there, but I think it's fair to say that you know people will be negotiating with the French photo magazines and the German magazines and wherever they can. You know, I don't think we're very far away. I don't know. I can't tell you that where the videos are, but I've heard this. What NBC wrote, I certainly heard, and probably worse.
Did you think anything useful came out of the questioning of Donald Rumsfeld in the Senate and the House?
No.
Do you think that the senators and the Congress members asked the right questions?
No.
What would you have asked Donald Rumsfeld?
Oh.
Will he speak to you?
No, Donald. Even though I've known him for 30 years, and I have to tell you, Donald Rumsfeld is a very bright, engaging, interesting man. You can disagree with him all you want, but he's always bright. He's the kind of guy that is—he's always nice to the underlings. He's always nice to the people that you know take care of his coat, serve him meals. He's a very pleasant, amiable, sort of a funny, nice guy. I knew him as a reporter during Watergate when I was at the New York Times, and I knew him afterwards. And he is funny, and he's actually, you know, the man I see now, I don't understand. The problem with the kind of show you had last week is you really need to have an underlying basis of information before you ask questions of a Secretary of Defense. I'm talking about in Plato's cave in a perfect world. And so somebody like me won't get much of a chance because it's harder, you know, because it's harder to tell me something that I may know something, I may know not as much as you, but I may know much more than you think I do about certain issues. And so it's always safe for the senator or the congressman. It's just a useless process. I mean, it makes headlines, and he did say some things. But the message that was gotten out was pretty much his message, which, of course, is interesting to me, which is that we really did a good job on this. Everything's under control. There's only 6 or 7 people. And I actually think he believes it. As I say, you know, this is a guy, you know, telling the band to play on the Titanic. I'm sure he thinks they can salvage Iraq. I'm sure the president thinks everything's okay because you can't get the bad news into them. And the real reality of what this meant, what the photographs mean, it does say an awful lot about Donald Rumsfeld that he didn't bother to look at these photographs until just recently.
And George Bush's response, first not being able to bring himself to apologize and standing with King Abdullah, what do you think he needs to do right now?
Oh, well, there's nothing. There's no way back on this. This is not just a question of the Arab world being mad at us for the mistreatment or seeing hypocrisy. The Arab world really sees sexual perversion in America. And we're talking about the moderate Islamists. They're really just, you know, they've always had problems with the loose ways of America, you know, and the sexuality and the openness about it. It's always been very confounding for the Islamic, the average Islamic believer, and now they just see us as a perverse society. And this, I'm saying this on the basis of conversations with people in that part of the world. It's just, you know, the sexual stuff that was done to our men with those women and with the photographs is a, for them is just simply perverse. And so I would venture to say you're going to see a significant drop-off of business and travel and contact with the moderate groups. I think this is a very, very, very damaging, way beyond Iraq. This has been very damaging to us in that part of the world.
And this first man, Jeremy Sivits, who will be court-martialed in Baghdad, who is he?
Well, I don't know much about him. He's just one of the six or seven guys. The only thing I know about him is I read about him in the Taguba report. He was somebody who was definitely one of the people in the night shift at the prison who was engaging in some of the what really amounts to is, you know, is torture of the prisoners. The sexual stuff that was being done to them is a form of coercion that is equivalent to torture for those particular individuals. They were being tortured, although they, you know, we didn't see them, and the, you know, we just saw a lot of awful things, but that was torture.
You've been listening to Seymour Hersh, Pulitzer Prize-winning reporter, exposed the My Lai massacre in Vietnam. His pieces are appearing in the New Yorker magazine. This is Democracy Now! When we come back, we look at the connection between prisons in Iraq and prisons at home. One of the lead guards, U.S. military police, captured in the photos, worked in Virginia prisons and at SCI Green, where Mumia Abu-Jamal is on death row. Stay with us.
It was back in 82. And I raised some cane when I come back to town. Left to be all I could be, come home without a clue. I married Dawn and had to settle down. So I hired on at the prison, guess I always knew I would. Just like my dad and both my uncles done. And I've worked on every cell block now, and things are going good. But then they transferred me to LS Unit 1. Swing low, swing low, swing low and carry me home.
This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman. The photos from Abu Ghraib repeatedly show Special Charles Grainer Jr. in photographs giving the thumbs up over piles of naked Iraqi men. Grainer is a military police officer. Reports are he was a prison guard in Virginia, as well as at SCI Green in Pennsylvania, state correctional institution there, where, according to the Sunday Herald, prisoners claim Grainer beat and humiliated inmates while he worked as a prison officer. SCI Green is the prison in southwestern Pennsylvania, where Mumia Abu-Jamal is held on death row. This is Abu-Jamal's latest commentary.
In the shadows of Abu Ghraib prison, the color photos coming out of the dreaded Abu Ghraib prison on the outskirts of Baghdad are racing around the world, silent yet eloquent testament to what Americans really think about the people they allegedly came here to liberate. The photos, especially in the age of the internet, are racing through the Arab and Muslim world and showing a side of the American character that seldom gets to be seen, especially abroad. The photos of naked men, some posed with laughing, jeering women, is the height of humiliation and tells everyone who can see that Americans hold the Iraqis and by extension other Arabs in utter contempt. This is not America, some politicians exclaim. I am appalled, another claims. Yet what is truly chilling, and perhaps more chilling than the naked human pyramid shown, is the sheer glee shown in the faces of the Americans. The photos reported in British tabloids of gleeful soldiers urinating, pissing on naked Iraqis tells the same baleful tale. This is the action of contempt, hatred, disrespect, and conquest. Are the Americans and the Brits liberators or occupiers? One need look no further than the faces of the photos of Abu Ghraib for the answer. When speaking recently with Emory Douglas, the celebrated former Minister of Culture and chief artist of the Black Panther Party, Emory brought back to mind an image that is almost lost in history. He reminded me of a police raid on the West Philadelphia offices of the Black Panther Party on August 31st, 1970, when the police, armed with automatic weapons, stripped men in the streets. I also thought of the infamous Charles Stewart case from Boston, when a white man claimed a black man killed his wife. The cops descended on Roxbury, black Boston, like a plague. They stripped men in the streets of Beantown. Many of the people who are now in Iraq, especially those in the reserves, are cops and prison guards. The treatment of Iraqis at Abu Ghraib has its dark precedents in the prisons and police stations across America. According to journalist Seymour Hersh of The New Yorker, there have been cases of sodomy against prisoners and even killing. Shades of Abner Louima, huh? If you hate someone, if you disrespect them, if you fear them, how can you liberate them? As we have said from the very beginning, the Iraq adventure is not and never has been about liberating the oppressed people of Iraq. Indeed, a recent USA Today CNN poll suggests Iraqis have come to that conclusion themselves, with 71% stating that Americans are occupiers. Americans may call it liberation, but they're bringing torture, humiliation, and domination. It is somehow fitting that these depraved events have happened in one of the most dreadful prisons of the Hussein regime. It shows the continuity of torture and terror. Now, if U.S. history is any guide, prepare for the whitewash. It is sure to come. From Death Row, this is Mumia Abu-Jamal.
That commentary recorded by the Prison Radio Project. Los Angeles Times Friday reported that prison video cameras have captured images of a prison officer allowing his police dog to attack a prisoner who was not resisting. Those who have seen the still secret tape say it shows a canine officer letting his German Shepherd bite a 20-year-old prisoner on the leg, even though the inmate was following orders and lying on the floor. No, this is not yet another picture of Iraqi prisoners being tortured by U.S. military at Abu Ghraib. This prison abuse took place in California. Physical and sexual abuse of prisoners, similar to what has been uncovered in Iraq, regularly takes place in American prisons with little public knowledge or concern. We turn now to Paul Wright, who is the editor and founder of Prison Legal News. He started the publication 15 years ago while he himself was incarcerated, released last December from the Washington State Reformatory in Moreau after serving 17 years. He himself was also an MP, military police. Welcome to Democracy Now!, Paul Wright.
Thanks for having me, Amy.
As you listen to this discussion from Abu Ghraib to the story of specialist Charles Grainer Jr., who is one of those captured in the photographs, one of the U.S. prisoners involved in the torture of Iraq, one of the guards involved in the prison torture in Abu Ghraib. He was a prison guard in Virginia. They say that's why he was given a senior role at Abu Ghraib, one of the few trained prison guards. Also worked at SCI Green. You're a military police officer. Can you respond?
Yes. Basically, I think that there's a real continuity of treatment, not just between American prisons and the U.S. Treatment of Iraqi prisoners, but this is also kind of a long-standing measure in U.S. counterinsurgency wars. I think it was around 30, 35 years ago now that the pictures of Vietnamese prisoners in the tiger cages in Vietnam became public, and once again, the United States government and military purported to be absolutely shocked that Vietnamese political prisoners and prisoners of war were being held and tortured in subhuman conditions. It seems that these things just go part and parcel with counterinsurgency wars. And here in the U.S., where there is very little political opposition, prisoners are routinely brutalized and mistreated as a matter of course.
Can you talk about this guard connection? with Grainer and your own experience as a military police officer before you were incarcerated?
Pretty much as far as Grainer, I don't know any of the specifics about his career or his role in Iraqi prisons. I understand it from some of the news reports, there's actually two of the guards involved in the abuse had civilian employment as prison guards. And Grainer, he was apparently a guard at SCI Green in Waynesburg. And what Prison Legal News has reported over the years is there's a high rate of very racist brutality by the guards at that prison. A majority of the prisoners are black and Hispanic men from the inner cities in Philadelphia and Pittsburgh. A majority of the guards, it's a very rural area, I understand, are white, and there's been a lot of incidents where prisoners are being beaten. In one case, guards were found to be smearing KKK and the blood of prisoners on the walls and prisons of the prison in Waynesburg, Pennsylvania. So I think that the fact that that type of culture permeates certain American prisons, it shouldn't be a surprise if that carries over into Iraqi prisons. And the key issue both in Iraq as well as in American prisons is the lack of accountability. One of the things, as far as my own experience when I was a military policeman, I served during peacetime, so there wasn't, or I should say during the Cold War, so there wasn't a lot of, there wasn't the actual hands-on experience that is now being seen in Iraq and in other counterinsurgency wars, whether it's Vietnam or Central America and other places. But I think it just goes with the whole mindset. The military, it's like prisons, it's a very brutal, dehumanizing environment where people are reduced to caricatures of human beings. They aren't even seen as being human. And I think that's kind of the key thing that makes these abuses possible, whether it's in American prisons or overseas, is once people are no longer seen as being human and just being the other guy or non-humans, that makes any type of abuse possible because you're no longer dealing with or talking about human beings.
Paul Wright, editor and founder of the Prison Legal News, started the publication when he himself was in prison for 15 years, now out, was a former military police officer, MP. As we turn now to our final segment that also involves a prisoner, Lori Berenson, the New Yorker who's been imprisoned in Peru for the last 15 years. Well, on Friday, her case has been in prison since 1995 for more than 8 years. On Friday, her case went before the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, which is based in Costa Rica. The court is the highest such court for members of the Organization of American States. Accompanied by the lawyer, former U.S. Attorney General Ramsey Clark, Lori Berenson's family said they're hoping to convince the court's judges to overturn the sentence against their 34-year-old daughter. If the court rules there's sufficient evidence, it has the power to order Peru to free her. In 1996, Lori Berenson was tried by a hooded military judge accused of terrorism, being a leader of the rebel group MRTA in Peru, and of conspiring to take over the Peruvian Congress. Ultimately, she was convicted of treason against the fatherland, despite the fact she's not a Peruvian citizen. During her trial, she was not allowed to see the evidence against her, nor was she able to defend herself against the charges. She was originally sentenced to life in prison. But in a subsequent trial, the sentence was changed to 20 years. In all, Lori Berenson has spent 8 years, 5 months, in 4 different maximum security prisons in Peru. Her father has just returned from the case being heard by the court. He joins us in the studio right now. Mark Berenson, welcome.
Good morning, Amy.
It's good to have you with us. Can you describe what happened in the court in Costa Rica?
She had a 7-hour hearing on Friday. It was an honor that Ramsey Clark in a wheelchair, was able to go. It was his first trip since his injury back in a couple months ago. And he and our other American lawyer, Tom Nutter, and Peruvian lawyer Jose Sandoval, did a wonderful job, as did the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights. The Peruvian lawyers were there to confuse, confound, and were very persuasive to judges who have to now look at the whole case. But since in the past, the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights and the Inter-American Court of Human Rights have said that the Peruvian laws which tried Lori are absolutely wrong, as has Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, WOLA, and the recently released report of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission from the government of Peru, have all said these laws are wrong, they're barbaric. They were formed by Fujimori, a tyrant out not only to defend terrorism, but to incarcerate anyone who stood in his way. How can this court, after saying that these laws are wrong for 11 years, now come to a decision that would go against Lori? It would be irrational. We must hope, we must assume victory, and the real complete victory would be Lori's freedom.
Now, your wife, Rhoda Berenson, Lori's mother, addressed the court. What did she say?
Rhoda spoke for over 30 minutes giving testimony on why this trial was a farce and that the second trial was no better than her hooded military trial in providing any evidence at all for a conviction and that Lori must be released. Our lawyers then pointed out the numerous human rights violations against Lori as defined by the American Convention on Human Rights. And all the Peruvian lawyers tried to do was mix up the dates and show how wonderful Peru now is heading towards democracy. Our lawyers pointed out that all of the changes Peru is making in its laws have been suspended and that real change has not occurred in the kind of sentencing that Lori had under the law she was tried upon. And so it makes no difference. It's all ex post facto. Lori's second trial represented double jeopardy. To give her a third trial would mean triple jeopardy. And it makes no sense. And I hope that the court will have the honor and the righteousness to do the correct thing, which is to order Lori's release.
And how did the court receive the arguments?
They were very attentive. There's seven international judges. This thing is now totally recorded on audio in English for those who spoke in English, such as Rhoda Ramsey Clark and Tom Nutter, and in Spanish for all the other participants. The president of the court, the honorable judge from Mexico, was quoted in the Peruvian paper saying that a decision will be reached by September. I do have in my experience, quote or no quote, Peruvian journalistic news is not often accurate, particularly in the Lori Berenson case, and certainly not accurate nearly one-fourth the time. So we hope for a decision this year. We hope for the real decision that we want, that would be the real Mother's Day present that Rhoda deserves. Her testimony was wonderful, and I hope she could be on this program soon to talk to you about that.
Where is Lori Berenson being held right now?
She's being held in Cajamarca in northern Peru, and after seeing this program this morning, I can say that the Peruvian system, it's amazing, is treating its prisoners today better than what we're seeing here. To say that Americans would be doing this to other people, what we've seen happening in Iraq or even in the United States. Peru has been known for her horrible torture in its prisons, but I will say that in the prison Lori is in, she has been treated well. There have been some improvements, and in her health, while it's still bad, there have been improvements in that as well.
I want to thank you, Mark Berenson, for being with us. Just returned from the Inter-American Court where Lori Berenson's case is being heard, the Inter-American Court of Human Rights in Costa Rica. We will keep you updated, and that does it for today's show. If you want to get information about Lori Berenson's case or any other case we've talked about on today's program, you can go to our website, and we'll link to others, democracynow.org. Democracy Now! is produced by Sharif Abdelkaddous, Mike Burke, Elizabeth Press, John Hamilton, Jeremy Scahill. Special thanks to Uri Galed, Chris Zucker, Mike DeFilippo, Rich Kim. Tomorrow, Democracy Now! Heads to the Free Library of Philadelphia, Montgomery Auditorium, 1901 Vine Street in Philadelphia. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks for joining us.